Remember that next week we've got the first lecture is on the effective stuff, and the second one is on user experience at Barclays. Okay, so we've got Rob's coming in to talk about UX at Barclays. Okay. Obviously, if anybody wants to work in UX, then you might also want to come and speak to the Barclays people about jobs and that kind of thing, which there'll be some time from now or so after. If people want to do that. Okay, so first of all, discussion topics. Voice loops as cooperative spatial emission control. So I presume everybody's done this now, have they? Pretty much. Is that it?
Yeah?
So we all met the deadline. We're not all struggling along. Okay, right, so what do we think to it? Yes.
I think it's quite interesting. And what I know is that there's a bit like a side effect of what is known as the multiple target effect.
Yeah.
Because people are able to concentrate in a single conversation over many conversations at the because of that. And even though it's not explicitly stated in the paper, all the setting and the spatial continuity kind of applies.
Yeah, no, that's very true. So, yeah, it relies on what's called the cocktail party effect or cocktail lunch problem. That's work done in 1950s by Cherry. Does anybody else know anything about the cocktail party problem? Cocktail party effect? Anybody? No? Do you know anything more about it? So when you're at a party, yeah, generally when you're at a party, you can listen to more than one conversation on the go. It also means that some conversations you'll pay more attention to, but if you hear something that you're interested in, like your own name or etc., then you can refocus, or something that which an event that you maybe took part in, say, then you can refocus to that sort of thing. So that's really what the cocktail party problem is about. One of the interesting things about that is that as we already know, from our brain and out of the brain, then the primary auditory cortex is split up into different frequencies. Okay, so it's different parts of it process different frequency ranges. So the interesting aspect here is, could you band vocal voice or sounds to different frequencies and therefore increase the intelligibility of highly parallelized information? So that's another. Okay, so anybody want to say anything more about the cognitive voice aids? Do we think that it's useful in modern UX? Or, yeah.
It seems very useful when you've got a lot of very complex organizational groups that need to be working across multiple zones at the same time. It's also sort of quite harrowing to see how it worked when everything was going wrong, not with the voice loops themselves.
Yes. Yeah, good. So you've also done the read the transcripts, that's nice.
It's more general level. What I saw here is that people kind of make use of a social cognitive phenomenon.
So those kind of phenomena are using apps, yeah, that's very true. So I mean, the reality is that this is really a bit more of the sort of safety critical stuff with regard to UX, but it still was user experience. And, you know, obviously, there's a human in the loop and their experience. And, yeah.
It gives you a bit of appreciation of like how we use the system. Like, the average person can go into like that kind of system and make utilize it as better. It's like the experience people and that sort of thing. So it kind of shows you, kind of gives you an awareness of the kid that like further capabilities of people who use the system a lot.
Yeah, so it gives you an awareness of the capabilities of the people who use the system a lot. I suppose in a lot of ways as well, the aspects that also come through is that it's used in a highly technical situation, a highly complex technical situation, to try and make things a bit simpler, but not removing any complexity in reality. I don't think it's removing any complexity. I think it's trying to make sure that the safety aspects are still there. And unless you're a power user, but also doing a really complicated job, it might not be so useful, but it is in that context. So, yeah. When we were talking about the kinds of things that would, you know, create a system for an organisation, actually using appropriate language or appropriate terminology, whereby that terminology might be jargon, it might be more complex, but it's appropriate. Not everything can be simplified, right? So yeah, it might seem to us that it's very complex and overly complex in some ways, but to them it simplifies, or at least
it makes
communication easier, because it's still using complex terminology that we wouldn't be able to understand, but it's still necessary for them to make communication more rigorous, I think. Anything else? Yeah.
I was interested to see what happened with the technology and the interfaces since that paper was written. And I found that in the International Space Station Mission Control, which works in a very equivalent way, they've been using artificial intelligence and planning algorithms to facilitate kind of direct communication and synchronization coordination between different flight controllers.
Yeah.
Which has in turn reduced the noise on the voice loops because they're communicating in other ways as well as just with the controllers on the voice loops.
Yeah. So it's very useful, but
it's less it's crucial.
Yeah. Cool. Anything? Anything about it? You got anything else to talk about? Anybody else? Okay. That's your last piece of coursework, you'd be happy to know, obviously, and you can go home for the vacation and after next week and get your revision stuff done. Regarding revision, obviously when we get back from Easter, then there's going to be a revision session, okay? So there's going to be a revision session of stuff that I think you want to revise for about an hour. Some of that's going to include how to answer questions and things that conventionally people may not understand how. I mean, by the time you're in this stage, you probably should understand how to answer these questions, but I think it's always useful to say. We'll also have an exam paper that's a real exam paper, well, two exam papers actually, two answer books to exam papers that represent good answers and bad answers to, it's actually not this course, but it's an architects course, and it's about trying to understand what makes a good answer and what makes a bad answer, okay, so that you can sort of do that yourself. And there'll also be some discussion about how lecturers mark, conventionally mark the work, okay? So what is it that lecturers or people who mark academics who are marking this kind of stuff are looking for? So that hopefully should be useful. Now, what you also need to do is, if there's stuff that you don't understand, if there's stuff that you're not sure about, if there's anything that you want me to go through again, the second hour will be specifically devoted to your kind of problems with regard to the revision. So you need to send me email before the event so that I can prepare to those pieces of work so that we can go through them as a group. Okay. Now, if I don't get an email, don't rely on other people. Everybody will send an email. If I don't get an email, then it will be a short 1 hour session. If I do get email, then it will go on for as long as it needs to go on so we can get through the revision. The final week is going to be no lectures at all. Okay. I'll be in my office. And you can come and see me on a one-to-one basis if you want to, with regard to questions, Q&A, that kind of thing. I'll be available this Friday for feedback, so if you need to speak to me this Friday, that's okay. Following Friday I won't be, because I'll be going to, I'm going to Korea, so I won't be here that Friday. So make sure, if you've got anything you want to talk to me about with regard to your revision, with regard to anything that you're not sure of or how to proceed, then you need to make sure that you get emailed to me so that we can go through it as a group, or you can see me so we can go through it individually one to one. I'd rather when you do it as not one to one, I'd rather you do it as you can if you like, but I'd rather you do it as a group, because there's often lots of people who have the same kind of issues that they with questions based on the parts of the course. Okay, any questions at the moment about revision or the course so far? Have you actually started looking at the notes for revision purposes or not? Yeah. No? Okay, well, you should start to think about that pretty soon, especially over the Easter vacation, and email me. Now, bizarrely, ours as normally seems to be, for most years at the moment, it seems to be something like about the 28th, 29th of May. Normally, every year it's been that up to yet, but that doesn't mean it's going to be this year. It's normally kind of around that time. Okay. So, what are qualitative methods and how do they differ? What are qualitative methods? Now I'm jet lagged, so generally if you guys don't start talking then it's going to be a very short lecture. Yes?
You can get very specifically like number of clicks, like the time it takes me to perform a function, things
yes.
You can measure.
Qualitative methods are something like the number of clicks, things that are measurable, things that we can have a metric.
More HCI.
Okay, and how do they differ from qualitative? Qualitative methods are how many clicks? Qualitative methods are something else. Qualitative methods are clicks and they're from HCI.
Well,
So qualitative methods are more text-based and more subjective. So in general, when we look at this, qualitative methods, we see we get something, normally we say that that's richer and deeper, and qualitative methods, it's less rich, but it's more broad. You can get more extent, okay, for the quantitative stuff, because we get more people. Okay, so who's read Zen in the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Excellent. You're reading it. Good, good. What do you think?
I think it's an interesting approach to life.
You think it's an interesting approach to life? Good. Excellent. Yeah? What page are you up to?
Alright.
There's a good bit around page 100, 120, then it starts to get weird. Anymore? Anybody else who's read Zen in the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Yes! Where are you up to? What page?
150.
150? So is that the page? Is that where it's got stranger?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
It's pretty good.
Yeah, there we are. It's good, see? So you guys should be reading it, because it's good. It's interesting. It gets real. As it goes on. Now we can talk about quantity and quality. You see? Later then, we can talk about quantity and quality. Okay, so it's obviously, you need to read that. Give me an example of a qualitative method, of how you might, a qualitative method. Focus groups, okay? Focus groups is a good one for a qualitative method. It's qualitative because you're not getting anything that's measurable, but you're getting opinion, you're getting subjective opinion, you're getting,
conversation with a purpose.
So when you have a conversation with a purpose, where does that kind of originate from? What domain does that normally come from?
Anthropology.
Good. Yes. So conversation with a purpose. Any more? The qualitative methods? Yeah.
Interviews.
Yeah. Interviews are good qualitative methods, yeah, because we're getting rich data back from them, yeah.
Profiles,
yeah. Yeah, definitely we can get that. We can get information back from profiles. Anything else? Okay, what about quantitative methods? Yeah.
Survey,
yes. Quantitative methods. Survey. Yeah.
And Google Analytics on websites.
Google Analytics on websites, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, definitely. Anything else? Yeah.
Timed experiments.
Timed experiments. Another one. Excellent. Timed experiments, yeah. Anything else? Okay. What are the key problems with laboratory-based work? It's subject to bias a lot, okay? Why is it subject to bias a lot?
People tend to want to please the experimenters.
People tend to want to please the experimenters, that's one. Why else is it subject to bias?
It's a single perspective.
Yeah, single perspective, yeah. If you get more people through there, that's it. Yeah.
It's not really the environment they're actually doing the...
It's not really the environment that they're actually doing it in, so that's... Okay, so the way to do this, to get around this, is this in situ, in the wild kind of work, which also goes along with this idea of longitudinal evaluation, okay? But that being the case, what's the problem with in situ in the wild? Yeah?
There are more uncontrollable variables, or variables that you don't necessarily know about the factors that are influencing.
There are more uncontrollable variables, that's true, yes, and those factors might influence, and we might not know those things. What are those called?
Confounding
variables. Okay, so those things are called confounding variables. And the whole point of laboratory-based work, the reason why we originally moved to laboratory-based work, is to try and control the confounding variables. If you can control the environment, you can control the confounding variables which are in that environment. But by controlling them, you remove ecological validity, okay, because it's not valid in an ecological sense. Okay. Yeah.
Could you not just do both, and then you could use them to sort of remove the, or to add back in the ecological variables?
Absolutely. You could absolutely do both. And oftentimes with most of this stuff, it's not, okay, so In the real world, it probably often is you're just going to get one shot at this. But if we possibly can, this isn't just a one-shot deal where we say we do laboratory work, will often allow us to think about whether we've got initially successful results and whether there really is some results, but whether this is something we want to evaluate or go back to the drawing board and do another iteration. However, once we've gone through the laboratory, then putting it out into the environment so that we can see whether we get problems in the environment, but from a longitudinal environment, the in the wild, then that would be a good, you know, that would be an excellent thing to do as well, because we get that back and we can make feedback.
Better science,
that's true, very much better science. So if we were going to do this in like, if we're going to have a number of different methods and a number of different ways of doing this, what would we call it?
Hybrid methods,
okay. Hybrid methods or triadic methods, okay. So those are the things that that's how we might do it. That's the way to control some of these biases and some of these variables. That we use more than one version, so we get a broader swathe of information that comes back to us. Okay. Because it's all about being confident in the generalizability of where the UX is going, where the evaluation is going. Okay, so what problems may exist when undertaking a single method evaluation? The reason why there's problems with single method evaluation is obviously because it's a single method, and so you can include biases you don't understand. You can't control for every confounding variable. Okay, you might think you are, but you probably aren't. So having different views on the data, having different views on the evaluation is always a better thing to be doing. It's always a good thing to be doing. Why is competitive evaluation different from other methods? First of all, what's cooperative evaluation sort of linked to at the design stage? It's a bit like IAF pair programming, but at the design stage there's a specific name for it. Participatory design, it's called. And at the evaluation stage, cooperative evaluation. So what's cooperative evaluation? So cooperative evaluation, yes.
Two people can work on one person. Does it say how you're someone's work while they're working?
Well, it's kind of like that. The thing that it is that we have users who aren't just guinea pigs, if you like, aren't just being experimented on, aren't just participants, but they are part of the design team. So those users cooperatively, in participatory design, users participate in the design process. So they're not outside of it, they are integral to the team. And they participate in the design of what should be built. Cooperative evaluation is the same thing, but for evaluation. So users will be evaluating with developers, with you as UXs, and they will be giving feedback. And that feedback will then be part of the evaluation and used to change iteratively the interface. Okay. And so it's often done in pairs. It's often done like pair programming. But it's not only done that way, and also both of them are normally UXs or in the technical team, if you like, somewhere in the kind of user team, okay, when this happens. Okay, what tools are at the disposal of the poor UXer? Pen and paper is at the disposal of the poor UXer, so if you've got nobody who's poor as a church mouse, like us academics, who've got no cash and struggling along, no money whatsoever, then it's pen and paper. Okay? What's the next kind of ones up from pen and paper? What would be the next thing if you're having a little bit more money?
Yeah. Voice recorder.
Voice recorder. So you have a voice recorder, and if you've got a lot of money, you'd have a field recorder, which is a kind of suit-up, awesome interphone kind of thing. So what's after that?
Especially
audio visual, so you might then have video as dwells on the game, and to make an increase in the video channel, to vote video how people are actually voting, how people are doing things. You might want to video how people are, what their facial expression is when they're doing something, okay, to see whether it looks like they're confused. And then if you want to go higher than that, if you've got a bit more money, yeah?
Eye tracking.
So eye tracking will conventionally set you back between 20 and 50,000 to do a bit of eye tracking. And reality is that that's why, if you've got a UX setup, the amount of money you can earn from the UX setup is quite extensive. If you provide 5 participants for a user experience study, then per day that is, and you want an eye tracking study, then you can conventionally charge around £6,000 a day to do it. That's the amount normally. Okay? So it's quite a lot. Okay, for 5 people. So what else is even more expensive? Research projects, that kind of thing. Okay. So let's go on. So we're going to do some of these little 5-minute breakout sessions, I hope, this week, because we're moving on quicker this time than last week, so that's good. Okay, so everything I've told you about now is in how UX kind of is supposed to happen. You've got this nice flow, we've got this iterative sort of development, we've got gathering of requirements, we've got then passing those requirements over to software engineers doing the translation, we've then got these nice ideas of not just doing the translation, but we've got these nice ideas of principles and well-found principles to do with development, and then we've got these nice ideas of scientific evaluation. All that sounds great, all fits together very nicely. But in reality, it's complete bollocks, okay? Because it just doesn't happen like that at all. Okay. These are the techniques and tools that you should use, and these are the tools and techniques that you should use. You know, I'm saying, yes, use 2 or 3 different methods to control for these biases. You've never got enough money to do that. Okay? You've never got enough time to do that. It's just not going to happen. It's mostly on these kind of things with SDS. Okay? When we talk about double blind trials or triple blind trials. Yeah, if you've got lots of cash, then it's a good idea, you can do it. But otherwise, you can't. You might have seen, I don't know, did anybody see the cancer research tweet or picture of the head of cancer research holding up a sign saying, thank you for your donations, they total £8 million. That means we can do 10 experiments. That's 10 experiments for 8 million. So do you think you're ever going to sort of go around and budget and say, I'll tell you what, here's a million and go off and do the user experience for that? Never going to happen. Okay, unless you're working for Boeing or, you know, some safety critical group, then yeah, that definitely might happen then. Or you're working for Google X or something like this? Yeah, never. But for the vast majority of us, we never get a million quid to do one experiment. It's just not going to happen. So you've got to be more realistic about this. And there's four words saying, you'll say it, and if you look at who's looked at the BBC bonus lecture from last year, the video with the slides for Penny Allen. Anybody? No? I don't know. What are you doing in that extra 60 hours for this course? You're supposed to be, you know, putting away for your own study. Come on. Anyway, it's realistic. In real life, it's practical. It's pragmatic, but mostly it's sloppy. Okay? There's nothing you can do about it, really. We try to do the best we can, And the good thing that you ought to know is what it ought to be like and how you're doing it, so you can try and get closer to what it should be like in the perfect world. But it's mainly pragmatic. You have to make trade-offs. You know, should we do a laboratory trial or should we do an in-situ longitudinal evaluation? Okay. Well, if you've got some time constraints, then it might be that you want to go straight to longitudinal because you can harvest information, it's not as rich, you can harvest information, you can't control for all variables, but it means that you can deploy immediately at least a version. If you've got extra time and you know that there's some issues because it's not working right, then maybe you want to say, well, let's do some laboratory stuff. So you've got this, you've got these problems. Now, we can even see that in ethnography is the shining example of longitudinal long-term work. Okay, it's all in situ, it's rich, and it is an ethnography is something that the anthropologists are really proud of, if you like, for being so good at what it does. And it is good at what it does. It elicits lots of rich information. Yeah.
What's the difference between ethnography
and ethnography is the actual product of anthropology in a lot of ways. So an ethnography is where you're actually in situ and you're writing. The outcome of that writing is an ethnography. So, as you can see here, though, this thing, quick and dirty, is also quite present. So we have all this great stuff here, great tools, you know, blah, blah, blah. But then, the reality is, even there, in this shining example, we've got quick and dirty methods. Okay? Because they realise that it's very likely, in a lot of cases, that you're going to have a perfect scenario. So therefore, you should all realise even when it comes to ethnography, and I've said before, you know, a real ethnographer would say that 6 months is way too short, you need 3 years to actually do it right, then the main thing to think of is that here we've even got a 30-minute quick and dirty way of getting some data back, because things change really fast. So you might only have 30 minutes to get this bit of data. It's better to have it, even if it's badly collected, to not have it at all, then you can make the decision about how it should be used or otherwise. Okay, now, there are a number of commissioning constraints. You can see here we've got the just-in-time, two-in-time, non-specialist, inadequately funded, presupposed outcome, implicit overlook, due diligence, and unconstrained experiment. What I want you to do in the next 5 minutes is to look in your notes, is to look, I'll put these back on, look at these, the idea is in the titles. And I want you to come up with what you think each of those things actually represents. If you can do it without looking at your notes, first of all, that would be an excellent thing. Okay? But the idea is, from what you know, you should be able to do, from what you know now, you should be able to derive a sentence or two about what you think your best guess these mean. Okay? These constraints mean. Okay, so we've got till quarter to. You've got till quarter to get this done. If you're on the table on your own, don't be with other people. If you're in a small two-person table, probably good to be in a bigger than two-person table. So you've got you two there, that's like matchmaking. Okay, so get with people so that you can do this. And you've got 5 minutes to come up with a sentence or two sentences, describe each one, try and do it first of all. I'll be coming to each table and asking you about this, so you want to think about it, because otherwise you're crucial.
No, that's fine.
Whereby commissioners, problems that you'll get as a UXer, because commissioners have got, you know, have these assumptions about these constraints based on the dimensions. So just think about that, you know, support people who
say. We think it's more reactive to like changes that commissioners kind of like force upon. So you can't like fly ahead too much, kind of like be with it.
Okay, so
if you plan ahead, things might change in that time, and all the work is going to be pointless, so you just do it just ready for when it's actually going to happen.
Okay, yeah, those are three views. Any other views on it? Okay, so just in time actually is a constraint whereby you've been given an amount of time to do your work by a commissioner, and the amount of time is just in time, presuming that everything is right. So you're given a tiny amount of space to get your bit of the work done. That's the problem, because it means that you've not been consulted in the original planning phase, and you've not been consulted in the iterative planning phase. And what happens is that you're given a tiny slice that the commissioner, the planner, thinks is appropriate. Okay, but they're not specialists. Okay, so that being the case, let's have a look at two of the time. Good to you guys. I'm going this way in a systematic, non-random way. Yeah, that's exactly right. It's just straightforward and obvious, yeah. So the two of the time constraints is that commissioners have just decided, well, there's this slice of time left, and you're going to have, and that's the time we'll just conveniently put to one side for user experience people to do their stuff. Okay? There's nothing complicated about it. They just don't give you enough time. So that's right. Okay, what about non-specialist?
The commissioners aren't specialists in what they're asking you to look at, so they don't know all the information you need to get from them.
Yeah, so the non-specialist is that commissioners, and oftentimes people who are higher up the project planning kind of track, if you like, yeah, aren't specialists in UX. And so they have no idea what they're supposed to be doing. And so they've planned something in their Gantt charts, they plan something for the project, which actually will give you nothing, okay? Because they're not specialists. So they've made some plans about what should happen in this, and they're not specialists, they've got it wrong. But you still have to deal with it, yeah.
Is that kind of a reason for the first two issues? Because they don't really know anything potentially about it, then they don't give you enough time, they just dump it on you, or they don't give you enough funding.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, sure. It's related to the first two. In fact, most of these constraints are actually related, you know, related together. But some of them, for instance, are just in time. They think, oh well, that's the best way to do it. We'll just do it just in time, iteratively just in time. But then there's too little time, and too little time means that I often think the too little time constraint comes from the fact that the commissioners they're not even trying. They just think, well, we've got to do this we've got to do this user testing. So give them as little space as possible, because mostly they think that the most important part is the software engineering, is getting it built. So getting it built is what they're interested in, not test writing or
What's the difference between this and how it's built?
So just in time is where they've actually made a plan that there's going to be UX work, and they've made a plan that you might do that UX work as a specialist, and you might even design that work. But they say that it's got to be ready just in time for the next iteration. But what happens when something goes wrong? What happens when then it moves over to probably too little time, if you like, because it's a just-in-time constraint, but we know that there's so much that can go wrong, there's so much feedback that you're going to get from users which might alter the next iterative cycle. But just-in-time mostly doesn't work for UX, because we need to alter what's coming afterwards. You can't, that's not really our plan. Whereas too little time, it's really, I think, just the fact that they've got the commissioners have got a total amount of time, everything else is filled up this time, and they've just got a little slice at the end. They're not really bothered, they just say, get off and do this, even though there's not really enough time for you to do it. Okay. I think this one is quite obvious. Inadequately funded. What do you think that is?
When the commissioners don't think it's important, so don't need any funding to do it.
Yeah. That's right. So when the commissioners don't think it's important, and they just give you an inadequate amount of cash, so they just think, well, you can do this on a few quid. reality is that that might not be the case because you need funding to go to see people, and you might need travel funding to get to people. You might need to give people an honorarium, so you might have to pay them to come and do the work, if you like. There also might be knock-on effects of in-time problems, because it might be that that if it's at a company, the amount of time that you're taking out of that person's day to do the work isn't accommodated in the funding costs. So it's sort of in-kind funding, if you like, that it's a time that's the problem. And that time hasn't been adequately represented to replace that person on the team that they're leaving, that they're not in for that day, half day. Yeah. Okay, presupposed outcome. Say again? Yeah, that's right, that's very true. So the commissioners already have this outcome that they want, just like Coke had the outcome that they wanted. You know, they wanted New Coke to be better than Old Coke, that's what they wanted, that's what they were expecting. And this is the same, that there's a presupposed outcome, because the commissioners think, this is what we want, this is what it's got to say, and that's it. Okay, so we presuppose this will be good. And you can link presupposed outcome with maybe too little time and just in time, because they say to themselves, well, we know what the outcome is, so we'll don't give them any time to get to that outcome, because we already know what it is, or we already know the outcome we want, and it's this one. Okay, not the truthful one. Yeah.
You don't have to have the funding as well, because they can say, well, we know what the result is, so well, we only need to ask one or two people. So that's not just any money, whereas as you actually know, we need to ask 10 or 20 people.
Yeah. That's very true, yeah, so it's also related to the inadequate funding, because if you know the outcome, why do you need to pay anybody to get it, okay, so, implicit overrule.
One, I think they believe that once you have enough money and time, then it will be enough to get the results.
When they've got enough money and time, this will be enough to get the results.
Yeah.
Okay, anybody else? So there's this idea that it's tolerable that it's going to be there. Okay, that's number one. Yeah, anything else? Okay, so for all of this, it's also linked together. So the implicit overrule is that they've not given you enough time to do the work. They've not given you enough time to do the job. So there will be an implied overrule over the time frame. Okay. It also means that there's two ways you can see this. There's an over and over time frame. This other thing is that they've not budgeted enough for the software engineering time. And so what they're saying is that the time of the other components of the project will eat into your time. There's an implicit overrun implied in the stuff that's not UX, which eats UX time, because UX time isn't seen as being great. No, it's not. It's obviously just not necessary. So the software engineering, there's an implied overrun in the software engineering. So for instance, the project planning says that you as a UXer might get 2 months or 3 months worth of UX work. But if anything has to be lost, it could be that 3 months, because the software engineering is implicit that the software engineering won't want to schedule. Okay. Same. So it's that kind of thing where things are eating up your time. Due diligence. So that sounds right in a non-real world to me, but think of Ted Nelson. Always have Ted Nelson in your head, authority is my line. So if you've got that context, authority is my line, what do you think due diligence is now? Okay, anybody else?
Someone hasn't done their job, here's that's kind of falls on you now.
Okay, so they haven't done their job previously, then suppose we knew that.
Not sure how ethical the actual commission.
is what all it's saying is that the commissioners are just saying, we know we've got to do we know we've got to do this user experience, we know we've got to include users, we know we've got to make the site accessible, we know we've got to make it usable, but screw it. We don't really care about any of that. Okay? All we care about is UX and getting it out on time, right? All we care about is software engineering and getting it out on time. So they're just saying your UX is them doing due diligence. It just looks like, in a pejorative way, it just looks like that there's UX in there. They can say we've designed this with accessibility in mind and usability in mind, we've done the correct evaluations, but they haven't, they just don't care. All they're doing is putting user experience in there to say it's been done, not because they actually want or care about user experience. Okay? They're enacting what people might say is due diligence, but it needs bugger all. Yeah.
What you're saying, it seems like the best way to make money out of UX is just to sign off on anything anything wants to do, rather than actually doing it, otherwise they won't give you the work. This is your stone.
Well, what I'm saying is that, what I'm actually saying is that that only seems right, because at the end when their project fails, like, say Coke, when Coke went tits up with regard to their, with their new Coke, okay, who do you think got sacked? The experiments, it's because they're obviously getting the wrong results. Okay? So, I would suggest that it's far more likely that you should make sure that they know the problems that they're enacting and have it written and make sure you document it and make sure you tell them about it, etc. Because when it goes wrong, which it will do, and when it doesn't work out how they expect it to, you need something to work back to say, well, I told you this was going to happen and look how it is. Otherwise, they'll say, you gave me these results, and your results are wrong, so you're wrong, not us. So you've got to make sure that you take yourself out of that loop. So if they want results that confirm something, then the reality is that you might give them the results for this project that confirms something, but you won't get the other one because you'll be the one that said that screwed up the evaluation. So it's all down to you. Okay, so it's a difficult balance to have, but I always think just document everything, make sure that you're honest about the documentation and about the problems they're going to encounter, and then if they want you to falsify results, don't do it. If you're going to falsify results, then expect to not get the next project, because when it all goes pear-shaped, they won't be the project. Yeah?
That sounds very, very similar to the first season.
Okay, it sounds very similar to the first season. Yeah. Men, I don't know this one, but this is good for original thought. Yeah?
That's
what, but?
Well, what is trying to do with the cigarettes and poisons? They try to create a campaign. It doesn't say that explicitly.
Yeah.
Researchers and researchers kind of conclude that yes, cigarettes are poisonous, but they say we don't care about your research. We want this.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, the point is that you have to then decide, you know, how you're going to navigate that. Okay. Unconstrained experiment. Obviously, unconstrained experiment pretty much only happens in research, I'd imagine. Where you've just got everything. You can spend as much time doing as much interesting stuff as you possibly can. Okay. Okay. So, information requirements is the next part in real life. So we've got flavour elicitation, ideas elicitation, informal elicitation, presupposed outcome, again, and laboratory elicitation. So, again, about 5 minutes, to go through and think about what these things might mean. Okay, that will be a note if you possibly can. What information are we going to get back, or what are the information requirements that you're given? Because the information requirements that a company wants might not be a full experiment every time. Okay. It might be something else. So you need to recognise their information needs, their information requirements, so you can back design the experiment and estimate the time that would be required based on that. You could also say, if you've been given, say, just 2 at a time, you might say, well, that's 2 at a time for a laboratory elicitation, but I might be able to do something with regard to flavour elicitation. But what do those things mean? So people may have got 5 minutes, and then, in fact, just Okay, this one I'm going to wrap into your tea coffee break. So you've got, so let's say you're going to come back at 12 minutes past, which means you're going to talk about this and get coffee at the same time. Multitasking. Okay? And we're coming back again, looking at each thing at 12 minutes past.